You have your Bible with you today. Turn to Hosea, not Isaiah, but Hosea, H-O-S-E-A. The first in the order that they are in the Old Testament minor prophets. So after Isaiah and Jeremiah and Daniel, Ezekiel, you come to those shorter books, and Hosea is the first of those. They're not in chronological order necessarily, but in the collection of that group of minor prophets, the first is Hosea, and we'll be reading from chapter 1, verses 1 to 11. The word of the Lord that came to Hosea, son of Beeri, during the reigns of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, and during the reign of Jeroboam, son of Jehoash, king of Israel. When the Lord began to speak through Hosea, the Lord said to him, "Go marry a promiscuous woman." In the New Revised Standard Version, that is translated, "Go marry a daughter of whoredom." How would you like to be described that way? "Go marry a promiscuous woman and have children with her. For like an adulterous wife, this land is guilty of unfaithfulness to the Lord." So he married Gomer, daughter of Diblaim, and she conceived and bore him a son. And then the Lord said to Hosea, "Call him Jezreel, because I will soon punish the house of Jehu for the massacre at Jezreel, and I will put an end to the kingdom of Israel. In that day, I will break Israel's bow in the valley of Jezreel." Gomer conceived again and gave birth to a daughter. And then the Lord said to Hosea, "Call her Lo-Ruhamah, which means not loved, for I will no longer show love to Israel, that I should at all forgive them. Yet I will show love to Judah, and I'll save them, not by bow, sword, or battle, or by horses and horsemen, but I, the Lord their God, will save them." After she had weaned Lo-Ruhamah, Gomer had another son. And then the Lord said, "Call him Lo-Amai, which means not my people, for you are not my people, and I am not your God. Yet the Israelites will be like the sand on the seashore, which cannot be measured or counted in the place where it was said to them, 'You are not my people.' They will be called children of the living God. The people of Judah and the people of Israel will actually come together. They will appoint one leader and will come up out of the land. For great will be the day of Jezreel." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray silently for the proclamation of God's word for all of us this morning. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your eyes, you who are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The transition from 8th to 9th grade was a tough one for me in many ways. During that summer, I had a short fling with a girl named Marlo Miller. We had a wonderful time for about 2 or 3 weeks. She dumped me for a sophomore in college. How do you compete with that when you're going into your freshman year in high school? And of course, as relationships go at that age, you don't tend to hear that from the source. You find out about it through the grapevine. Oh, I hear you got dumped by Marlo Miller. Oh, well, oh, really? Oh, okay. Well, then I start a little thing with Kathy Doak. I got back at that sophomore college. 8 years later, I married Marla Miller. So there you go, Johnny Jacoby. That'll teach you. But I started up a little thing with Kathy Doak, and we were just having a wonderful time together when I found out she dumped me. For a guy who was a year older than us, at least she didn't dump me for a college guy. She dumped me for a sophomore, and he happened to be my brother's best friend, and also the older brother of my best friend. That was a little awkward. That little dance went on for another year or so. But it's a terrible feeling. How many of you remember? You have your stories. Luke just said, I'm not raising my hand. He's liable to ask me about it afterwards or have me stand up and tell everybody about it. Philip Yancey in our meditation for silent preparation brings up country western music. You know, if you really want to have some bad memories aroused, listen to country western. I can remember we were riding along in the car one day when our boys were younger, and they had some awful music on. And what really made it awful were the words. And Marlo says, get that music off. Change the station. Are you listening to the words to that song? And one of the boys says, yeah, Mom, you want some country music? All my exes live in Texas. Is that what you want us to be hearing? And she didn't have an answer for that other than to start laughing. But sometimes you gotta laugh or you'll end up crying. You don't forget, do you? You don't forget those times. And even the ones we can kind of, with a smile on our face, tell stories about today, doesn't change the fact that we got dumped. Someone decided that they'd prefer something or someone else to us. Boy, you go back to creation. And for all those days, God, just by command, creates the world. Let there be light, and there's light. Let there be creeping things. My one granddaughter is scared to death of creeping things. And there were creeping things. Let there be water. But on that final time, God changes the whole way he does creation. And it's portrayed for us in the Genesis narrative that God kneels down into the very dust of the earth. And in a very intimate act, he molds man, human, out of the miry clay, as some authors have put it. It's a very intimate, special act. And then the scriptures say he breathes his breath into Adam, into the human. And that crown of creation bears the very image of the Creator. God makes the boulders by command. Boy, he did a good job in Garnet Valley, didn't he? I mean, they are everywhere. But they're not made in the image of God. They're created by God. They can't respond to God in relationship. Only the crown of creation has the capacity to have a relationship with God. in his image, God has created us. And without exception, Isaiah tells us, and Paul repeats, none of us are an exception. We've dumped him. All of us who have knowledge of God have chosen not, without exception, to refuse to acknowledge God. And of course, his own special people, who he has created through Israel, through Jacob, he who strives with God, they've gone astray. We all know it from Sunday school, don't we? We, like sheep, have gone. And you know why we have the capacity to hurt. Even all these years later, it must have just been 7 or 8 years ago that I was going into the ninth grade. All those years, 7 or 8, I still remember. Marlo kind of giggles when I said I remember that first time when we went to the dance together at the swim club. And danced on top of the roof of the filter room. You were wearing white clam diggers and a red and white striped top. And the first time I said that, she giggled and she said, I love that outfit. That was a special outfit. And a couple of weeks later, I heard that she was going out with Johnny Jacoby, who was going into his sophomore year at East Stroudsburg. What's going on here? And over and over and over again, the Lord restores that relationship with his people, and they turn their backs on him. So now he calls the only writing prophet from the northern kingdom. There's a little trivia question for you. There were other prophets in the northern kingdom, Elijah and Elisha, the most famous of them, but they never wrote. The only writing prophet we have who prophesied specifically from the northern kingdom and in the northern kingdom, living there, you'll recall Amos came up from Judah to prophesy to the northern kingdom. But here is Hosea, who lives there. And God gives him an awful assignment, warning I received one 16 years ago. I hate new situations. I really wish I was still going to the Methodist Church in Huntington Valley that I grew up in, where I knew everybody since I was a baby, and where I could predict what was going to happen, where if I walked in late, I know my parents would be sitting in the second pew on the right from the front. And I get very clearly called into interim ministry, where every 2 years you got to meet a whole bunch of new people. And you find yourself calling Art Tom, and you find yourself calling Bob Bill, and Brenda's called Laura, and you realize afterwards, I don't think that's right. I'm so embarrassed. And sometimes you just look at people and you freeze. I'd rather not live with that. But the Lord ambushes us, doesn't he? So he ambushes Hosea, and in case you're wondering, would the Lord take you someplace you don't want to go? Yes. This whole sophisticated idea of God is a gentleman, he would never force you to do anything you don't want to do, not true. Even that quaint idea that God is just sitting around waiting for you to be moved to come to him. No, he's not. Tell Paul that. Was God content to sit around for Paul? No. He blinded him and called out to him and scared the stew out of him. Paul said, who are you? I'm the Lord who you're persecuting. What? God's not a gentleman. He loves us dearly. And he has only the best in mind for us. But to get that best, God will do some outrageous things. So he says to Hosea, I want you to go marry a whore. What? This is really you, Lord. Tell me again tomorrow night in my sleep. Hi, Hosea. I want you to go marry a whore. It sounds so crude that way, the way I just said it. Doesn't it sound better the way it reads in the scripture? A promiscuous woman. No matter how you say it, that's what God tells him to do. And God bless him, Hosea does it. In a few weeks, we're going to start to study Jeremiah. Oh, boy. Talk about getting put through the ringer. I mean, he has him run through town waving his dirty underwear. I mean, God will go to any lengths. So he does it. Hosea is obedient. He marries this woman, Gomer, who is as described. And they have their first child. And that first child, as you'll see in the text, is to be named Jezreel. They don't say in the text, but Jezreel means God sows. And of course, this is to symbolize God's condemnation of the northern kingdom. His judgment upon that monarchy, the house of Joab and Jeroboam, This city of Jezreel was the military center of the northern kingdom. Would be like us naming our oldest son or daughter Pentagon. Charming name, isn't it? Can't you hear it while your daughter's out there playing soccer? Go, Penna, go, you know. Always symbolizing God's judgment upon them as a people. And then I have another child, Lo Ruhamah, daddy's little girl. And daddy's little girl is not to be named Chloe or Violet or Charlotte or Savannah. That's some of our girls. No. Her name means not loved, no mercy. Oh, look at the cute little girl. Why don't we name her Loveless? Ooh. That hurts, doesn't it? A symbol of the withdrawal of God's love from Israel, and as the text tells us very clear, but not from Judah. That will come later. Or will seem to come. And then finally, another boy is born, the baby boy, Lo Am I, and that means not my people. You don't belong to me anymore. Every time you see this kid, just remember, have turned my back on you. Have it with you. You are not my people. Hosea in his prophecy will get more specific and go on to explain just how God will use the Assyrian Empire to destroy once and for all that northern kingdom. But you'll notice the last paragraph, I'm sure you all noticed. It sounds so triumphant, doesn't it? Sounds like Christmas. Yet the Israelites will be like the sand on the seashore. Remember when he said that to Abraham? Which cannot be measured or counted in the place where it is said to them, you are not my people. You're going to be called the children of the living God. The people of Judah and the people of Israel will come together. They will appoint one leader and they will come up out of the land. For great will be the day of Jezreel. Hosea was the first of the prophets to begin this pattern in his preaching and writing of alternating the word of judgment with a word of hope. Isaiah, who prophesied just at that same time as Hosea. In fact, if you look at the list of kings under whom Hosea prophesied, you'll find that Isaiah was prophesying in Judah under those same kings. He will mimic Hosea's style of words of judgment and condemnation from the Lord, sprinkled in between words of hope, words of grace and coming salvation. There's hope for us all. But what God wants to do with Hosea, not just with a message, and by the way, you'll see in the sermon outline, this is not a metaphor or a mere metaphor. Hosea is commanded to do this, and he actually does it. He acts out the relationship that Israel has with God. He incarnates God's message to Israel. And we're called to do the same. Individually. And as a body. As a people. And not just a congregation, but as the body of Christ beyond our own congregation. But it starts here in our individual lives and in our corporate lives. We live what God calls us to do. In kind of a fun way, I saw that happen. You crazy session people, whoever you are. We do have a session at this church, don't we? Yeah, they're listed on the back. I've learned some of those names. They assigned Brenda, the new elder, to be in charge of children and youth ministries, which is really a thankless job when there are very few children and teenagers here. But there are some, and she has tackled it with enthusiasm. And then the session comes up with an idea. Why don't we have a slip and slide on the hill on the hottest day in the summer, right there in the middle of the summer? Let's do that, Brenda. Actually, it may have even been Brenda's idea. So Brenda made an outline of plans and activities for everyone to follow. She presented them at the session meeting. She had the church treasurer write a check, and then she went away on vacation. She was there. And we were hardly into the afternoon before she was wet. She was prepared for that. She was not only there, her family was there. She encouraged everyone to bring people. She brought her whole family. They were there, from the oldest to the very youngest. You haven't seen anything until you've seen a little kid who's not even a toddler yet, who goes down the slip and slide with his father, and after about two or three times of that, with a little tiny toy inner tube and everything else, before you know it, he's elbowing his father out of the way. Get out of my way! He can't speak, but he's speaking. I don't want to go down with you, I want to go down on my own! Every time his father turns his back, the little kid is jumping on this thing and everybody's holding their breath. What's going to happen to this kid? He's going faster than any little kid ought to be going because he's got such little body mass. He's got all the soap all over him. He's like a little slippery spitball going down there. Well, why not? I already saw my grandmother going down there. And Tom, who was helping to set up this thing, who kind of just looked like the mechanic for the day, and he's kind of giving everyone instructions on how to do it. Before you know it, you turn around, and there he is sliding down the hill. Now, Marion never did it. But she was keeping track of everyone who was and making sure everybody got a soft pretzel and a water ice. And then everybody got to know everyone who was there. Granny Kathy brought her grandchildren. They never had a chance. We're not called to stand back. Called to get dirty. Called to get involved. And some of you are going, oh, you know, you told us this 30 years ago, we'd be ready and willing to run. We're getting a little tired. Well, God's got a way. He'll show it to us. But the question that we need to ask this morning. Are we, like Hosea, willing to be obedient? Hosea didn't live a very happy life. He sure will lead an obedient life. And later in the prophecy, we'll see that God says, I want you to go out and find her, because after giving birth to the three children, she goes out and begins to sleep around. And she's living with someone or someone's else. And God says, I want you to go out and get her and bring her back home. I want all of the nation to see just what you're doing. I want you to humiliate yourself by going out and buying her back and bringing her home. Redeem her. We sing the songs, don't we? Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Remember when you used to buy things at the Acme? And after you finished paying for your order, a little machine would spit out stamps. Green stamps. And you had a book. And if you had older kids who were neat, you would let them do it. Otherwise, you'd keep them away from them because they would lose them all. And you would take those green stamps and, you know, you'd have to lick them or sponge them, and then you'd put them in the book. And then you would take the book to the redemption center. And you got your free stuff. been redeemed. By the blood of the prophets, but in the fullness of the time, by the holy and pure blood of the unblemished Lamb. We've been redeemed. And Hosea foreshadows that for us incarnationally. As God says, I want you to marry Gomer. And several years later, now I want you to go and redeem her. Buy her back and bring her home and reconcile with her and love her, because this is what I will do with my people Israel. We're all a bunch of dirty, rotten sinners. We need to be redeemed. And so do our friends or neighbors. So get your bathing suits on, pour some soap over yourself, and start sliding down that hill. And if you're good, we'll give you a soft pretzel and a water ice when you're done. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your faithful servant, Hosea. And so many others who joined him in faithfulness to you. We thank you that no matter how far we have run away, you run ahead of us and surround us and gather us to yourself. We are very grateful for that this morning, O Lord, and we pray that our hearts would never grow cold toward those who are still in need of your saving grace. We thank you in Jesus' name.